Oh. on the fact that how God loves us. And then I preached on the importance of how we are to love God. Today I'm coming to choosing to love ourselves. Choosing to love ourselves. Choices. Look at the word choosing first. Now I'm very loud. It's weird. Every day is a gift, isn't it? Every day is a gift that requires making choices. Choices about what we're going to accomplish through the day. Things that we're not going to do. We make choices. Some questions, some choices to make are simply saying a yes, simply saying a no. Some require real deep thinking. We have to take time to make those choices. Some of the choices are life-changing choices. We have the power of choice. One thing we do have is the power of choice, and it's a gift, this power. God's never taken it away from us. It's a gift. But quite often we take it completely for granted. And when we come to God's Word, when we come to the Bible, we can see time and time again how people made choices. They made certain choices about their lives. And as you read about the choices they made, you then read the consequences of their choices. The first story, which I know I've mentioned quite a few times with us, is the story of Adam and Eve. You will not surely die, for God knows that when you eat it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Eve stared longingly at the fruit. She went to touch it. It's lush, it's big, it's colourful. Oh, it's so beautiful. She couldn't take her eyes off of the fruit. It transfixed her thoughts. Oh, her mouth began to water. A thought came into her mind. Did God really say you mustn't eat from any tree in the garden? She looked at the fruit again. Oh, it looks so amazing. More amazing than any of the fruits in the rest of the garden. And as she looked, reaching her hand to it, she remembered. You may from the trees of the garden, but you must not eat the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden. That's what God says. And you may not touch it, or you will die. The serpent's words entered her thoughts again. But you will not surely die. You will be like God, knowing good and evil. Knowing good and evil. Oh, such a beautiful fruit. I'll be like God. She took a bite. She gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. And then their eyes were opened. And they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. And then the man and his wife heard God, the Lord God, walking through the garden in the cool of the day, aware of their nakedness, aware of what they had done. They ran and hid from God in the garden. The story of Eve and her husband Adam is about being tempted to disobey God and choosing to be disobedient, choosing to fulfill their own desire, choosing what she, Eve, wanted. And that choice greatly damaged their relationship with God and had huge implications on God's creation and upon every person that has ever lived. And from that story in Genesis 3, right through the rest of the Bible, as we see people make their choices, as we see their consequences, we also see God's love. We see God's grace. We see his mercy. We see his desire to be in relationship with each one of us. We see the desire that he wanted to walk with us like he did with Adam and Eve in the garden. You see, in case you haven't got it yet, God loves you. God loves you. And you are loved, you are precious, you are valuable, and you are highly prized. And I need to say that to myself. We are. Love is the grandest thing in Scripture. It is who God is. It is his divine motivation for doing everything that he has done. It's his motivation for why he created Adam and Eve in the garden in the first place. It was his love that moved him to form and rescue Israel. It was his love that sent Jesus Christ as the perfect lamb, the spotless, perfect lamb, to die on the cross, to give his life as a sacrifice that we can be forgiven, so that we can be forgiven for our disobedience and stand before him, stand before God, washed clean, holy, forgiven. It moved God to create each one of you in your mother's womb, even though he knew the pain that we were going to cause him. It moved God to act so we can have a rich and full relationship with him. His love has moved him to be gracious, merciful, oh so patient. His love moved him to adopt us into his family. Even though he knows us better than ourselves, he chose us. He loves us unconditionally. You are loved. I'll say it again. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved. Those that were here a couple of weeks ago, I spoke on these words where Jesus is asked, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replies, "Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment." As we remember, as we grasp hold that we are loved by God and what God has done for us, it gives us the motivation to love him back. As he loves us, we allow his love to fill us up and overflow. We can love him back. We need to note that it is a command to love him with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, and elsewhere in the Bible it says all of our strength. No, we love him because he loved us. He loved us first, and we need to be intentional about loving him. And then Jesus goes on to the next neighbor as yourself. All the laws and the prophets hang on these two commandments. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love yourself. It is a command to love your neighbor as yourself. Command. Joyce Mayen says there is something important here that I think people often miss. You cannot give away something you do not have in you. How can someone love another person if they don't love themselves? Love your neighbor as yourself. Think about it. How can someone love another person if they don't love themselves? Loving ourselves is a choice. It's a daily choice. When I became a Christian, I really did, and I mean this, really hated myself. I had made life choices that had catastrophic consequences that literally ripped my heart apart. At the time, before all of that happened, I thought my choices wouldn't have any consequences, and so often we often don't think about consequences. Just like Eve, I wanted, I desired, I needed, it was so good, it made me happy. But all those things only lasted for a time. They weren't everlasting. And then suddenly everything came crashing round me, came crashing down. And I met with the consequences. And those consequences then turned to deep hatred within my life. One of the really tragic consequences of Adam and Eve's disobedience is that all of mankind lost their sanctuary with God. They lost their deep personal relationship with God. They lost the importance of being with Him. And because of that, every human being struggles with feelings of inadequacy, despair, insecurity, and loneliness. And this puts us on this continuous but fruitless search for that security, for that belonging. And we do that through worldly success, through the people around us, by looking for their approval. We define ourselves by the approval of others. We define ourselves by the money, by our status. We do it by finding things and people to fulfill us, rather than actually standing on the truth of who God says we are. And you know what? Satan never loses one moment to get to work in our lives and exaggerate that despair and that loneliness, that insecurity. He doesn't miss one moment. At the beginning, right there at a young age, he uses our imperfect parents, to feed us with more lies to make that exaggerate. And then we end up in school. We ended up with loads and loads of children trying to make it. And of course, you can see Satan getting in. I was bullied at school. I hated school like anything. And there was Satan bringing in how much I am alone, that I am not worthy, that I am not lovable, that I am not everything. I really believe in the world that we live in today, if anyone reaches adulthood with any form of really good, solid self-worth, I believe that's because they are a miracle, that people have been praying for them, and they're a testimony of the power of God at work in their lives. are robbed of our understanding of our true self, our true worth, our significance. And so often we take on those lines that we are unworthy, insignificant, unlovable, we are unlikable. And I think because of this, we've become really confused about what it means to love ourselves. And as I was reading this and researching it and thinking about it, it's really interesting how I found a number of Christians saying, it's really wrong to love ourselves, we mustn't love ourselves. No. And then other Christians then going into the reasons why we do need to love ourselves. And I've come to the conclusion, I believe, that there's a good way and a right way of loving ourselves, and there isn't a good way and a right way of loving ourselves. And the wrong way, I call it the lover of self. And 2 Timothy 3:1-5, I think, really sums up the problems with being lovers of selves. You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be very difficult times. That people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. Lovers of selves. People who think of themselves more highly than they ought. Self-centered, egocentric, selfish, vain, conceited, proud. Everything they do for their benefit. It's all about I. What I want, what I desire, my comfort, my rights. It's all about me and what will make me happy. And isn't that the world that we live in today? In reality, people are just trying to fulfill that deep-seated need within them. In reality, they're trying to find an answer to their feelings of inadequacy, despair, insecurity, and loneliness. In reality, they're trying to find the hole that is missing by God. And because of that, they move on from one situation after the other, more materialism, more money, on to the next crazy thing that's going on, the next whatever. Sometimes not caring who they hurt in the process, quite often hurting themselves. And the consequences can be life-changing. It's a life without Christ. A life without God. But we have to be really, really honest. Because if we're really, really honest, we have to admit that we can still struggle. Those of us that are Christians, those of us where we know God is sitting at the core of our lives, we still can struggle with these issues. You know, Eve walked with God in the Garden of Eden, and she still took the fruit. And what about David? King David, God's chosen king. He was a man after God's own heart. And yet, one day, when he was walking on his rooftop, he was bored, he was unable to sleep. And he saw her. She was beautiful. She was, desiring. She just, he couldn't look away from her. He just wanted to touch her, caress her. She was mesmerizing. Just to embrace her. Just to smell her fragrance. He asked his servant who she was. Isn't that Bathsheba, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. David kept looking at her. She was so elegant, such wonder. His desire grew for her. He sent for her. She came to him, and they slept together. You can read that story from 2 Samuel 11. David's choice to sleep with a married woman to fulfill his selfish desire caused great suffering. He tried to deceive Bathsheba's husband, and when that didn't work, he had him killed. And there was a baby that was the result of that one night, and the baby died. In addition, God made it really clear to him that God saw what happened. He didn't hide it from God. God knew what had happened, and God told him that there's going to be disaster on his family and the sword would always be against him. And the results were that one of his sons tried to take David off the throne and slept with David's wives, and 3 of David's sons were killed by the sword. David was a man in the portrait of God, and he still got it wrong. He still allowed his eye, his selfish desires to rise up. Unfortunately, at times, even with us Christians, we allow our eye to rise up. Unfortunately, when that happens, it can be quite ugly. It can affect our perceptions, affects our relationships, our thoughts, our emotions, and our behavior. Our love can become very conditional and unforgiving, where we expect high of people. And when people don't love us the way we want, then we can get hurt and pain, and it can cause great disunity. Only God can feel the deep needs within us. Only God can feel that insecurity, our need for love. And from this position, then we can love ourselves and each other. Jesus strikes at the very heart of the lovers of selves. From Luke 9:23-5, he says, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. For God, what good is it for someone to gain the whole world then and yet lose or forfeit their whole self? Taking up our cross, denying ourselves, turns us from lovers of selves to a godly love for ourselves, where the I is no longer in charge of our lives, where Christ rules our hearts, where God sits on the throne of our lives, where he can fulfill the needs. It's really important to notice here that it's a daily choice. It's not that one choice when we ask God into our lives and we committed ourselves to him and then we can just get on with our lives. It is daily. Jesus says daily, daily, daily choosing to take up a cross, daily choosing to deny ourselves, daily choosing to follow Jesus Christ, to live according to his standards for our lives. Joseph found favor in the eyes of the master, the Potiphar. He put Joseph in charge of his household. He entrusted to his care everything he owned. Now Joseph, he was well built, so the Bible says. He was handsome. And after a while, the Potiphar's wife took notice of Joseph. Come to bed with me, she pleaded regularly. Come to bed with me. But he repeatedly refused. No, with me in charge. My master does not concern himself with anything in this house. No. Everything he owns, he is entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than me. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? Joseph stood his ground. But one day he was alone in the house and he was caught unawares. She quietly crept up to him and grabbed hold of his cloak. Come to bed with me, come. Again he refused and said, no. Eager to flee from his presence, he ran, but in the flight, he left his cloak in her hand as he ran out of the house. You can read about that in Genesis 39. I love the fact that Joseph was able to stand up against temptation, the temptation that was thrown at him. How easy it would have been for him to have said yes. How easy it would have been for him to sleep with the Potiphar's wife without thinking about consequences or his actions. Joseph was secure in God. He knew the blessings of God. He knew that it was because of God that he was in the position that he was in Potiphar's house. And he understood that by sleeping with another man's wife would cause huge consequences to him, to his relationship with God, and to the Potiphar, and actually to the wife. He knew and he trusted in God and in God's love for him. He chose every day to deny himself, to live in God's love, and to love back. And this brought him great honor within the Potiphar's household. Thus, when the Potiphar's wife came to him and tempted him with her body, he was able to say, no, no, God loves me. He has made this all happen to me. I choose to love myself and recognize that this would be a great wrongdoing against myself, the Potiphar, and God. No, I will not give in to this temptation. I choose to deny myself and my human needs. I respect and love myself and God to do that. Joseph unfortunately didn't end up wrongly accused of adultery, and thus he was put in prison. But because of his godly actions, God blessed Joseph in prison and raised him up at a time of great unjust suffering. You see, loving ourselves is grasping hold of who we truly are based upon the truth of God's word. It's based upon who God says we are. It's not based on our emotions, which is probably the mistake I make too often. It's not based on what the world says about us. It's not based on Satan, because they are all lies. Loving ourselves is based on God's love for us. A true biblical self-concept contains both strength and humility. This is actually a quote I read and I really loved it. It contains both strength and humility, both sorrow over sin and joy about forgiveness, a deep sense of our need for God's grace, and a deep sense of the reality of God's grace. We can learn to accept ourselves, embrace who we are, embrace our personalities, even our imperfections. Knowing that although we are not where we need to be with Christ, denying our selfish I, taking up the cross, we are able to make progress and move forward. us because we have weaknesses and imperfections. We don't have to reject ourselves because of them. God wants us to love ourselves and enjoy the people he has made us to be. And so we can learn with that perspective to be gracious with ourselves, to be forgiving with ourselves, to not keep beating ourselves over the head when we get it wrong. Remember, love keeps no records of wrong. We can learn to be merciful with ourselves. We can learn in love to respect ourselves and not continue to put ourselves down. We can learn to be in self-control of our lives, recognizing sin and wrongdoing does have consequences. Recognizing that people, things, the next craze, money, status will not fulfill the deep-seated needs within us. It is God and his love that can only fulfill that need. And with that, then, we can love ourselves. I've been on a very, very long journey to accept God's love for myself. And a very long journey to learn to love myself. And with that, to love others. And there have been times, and I still do really struggle, to accept fully how much God loves me. Then grasp with that love that I can love myself. And again, it's a choice, and it's a daily choice. It's a daily choice to recognize the truth. I'm becoming American, by the way. You notice I spell it in American spelling. I'm getting confused. Recognize the truth. The truth. Standing on God's word. Standing on who God says we are. Knowing that what the world says is a lie. Knowing the feelings of inadequacy, despair, insecurity, and loneliness is a lie because God is with us and God loves us. In love, we can recognize those needs, but rather than turning to become lovers of self, turning towards things that actually just cause a lot of pain and hurt, we can learn to turn to God. Turning to him, denying that selfish I within us, and make the choice to allow God fulfill all those needs within us. It's standing on the conviction by faith that God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we may have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. The Bible says, I am loved. The Bible says, you are loved. And that we are all worthy of love. Thus, we need to stand on that conviction, not on our emotions, not if we whether we feel it or not, or what other people say. We stand on the convictions of what the Bible says, that we are worthy of love, that God loves me, and so I can love myself. I am loved. It is true. Right? Because if we say it's not true, if we can't receive God's love and love the person that God has made us to be, then are we not calling God a liar? Not loving ourselves is allowing the lie of Satan to manipulate us and strangle the truth within us. Christ died to give us freedom from the works of the evil one. Christ died because God thinks we are worth saving, because he wants to spend eternity with us. Who are we not to love ourselves? Who are we to say any different? God loves us. God loves you. I'm going to keep saying it. The more I say it, the more we all believe it. God loves you. God loves me. And because of that, I can love myself. I love myself. I spoke a few months ago about how God sees us as diamonds, that we are loved, special, unique, worthy, precious. You see, because the Bible says so, because he says I am worthy of love, I can stand on the conviction that he sees that diamond inside of me. I might not see it. Quite often I don't. But he sees it in me. And so I can stand on the truth of his word and stand on that conviction that he sees me, that diamond inside of me, and that I'm worthy of his unconditional love. I am worthy of his love, therefore I love myself. Seek transformation. Talk to yourself. Talk to yourself. One of the things that I had to go through in order to get rid of all that hatred in my heart was through quite a few years of counselling. And my counsellor used to make me every day stand in front of the mirror and tell myself that I love myself. It's the most horrible thing. You try it. You go home and stand in the mirror and it's like, it gets easier as you do it. But you do need to stand there going, of course, I don't even know I was a Christian at that point. I can't remember. But just standing there, you're like, I can't say it. I can't talk to myself, let alone tell myself I love myself. But in counselling terms, I'm not a counsellor, so I can't go into the whole process, but in counselling terms, talking to yourself does actually have real benefit. And it really helps to get truth into the heart of, into your heart and into your mind, and really help you to learn to stand firm on who God says you are. So I do encourage you, get over yourself, stand in front of your mirror each morning and say, God loves me, I love you. God loves you, I love me. One or the other, I don't know, talk to yourself in the mirror anyway, however you say it. But also, I've been reading a book recently saying about the importance of talking to ourselves, and so often we think so much. I think so much in my head, it's catastrophic. I tell you, it causes me so many issues. And the book where I was reading was saying, you know, we should actually get over ourselves and talk out loud, because when we talk out loud, we can catch all those negative things that we say about ourselves. We can catch all those negative thoughts that we think about other people. We can catch all those things. So often when they're there, you don't really quite catch them, they're just all going around. Speak it out and catch it. And as soon as you catch it, as soon as you realise you're speaking negatively about yourself, as soon as you realise what you're saying is not love, then you can pray into that, break it off, and ask God to fill you with love for yourself and that person and that situation, etc. So talk it out. Prayer, obviously, is really major when it comes to really learning about who we are. God, learning about his love and helping us to love ourselves. Pray, Lord, Father God, help me to see myself the way you see me. Help me to see myself through your eyes. And of course, Bible study, meditation on his word. We need, in order to gain a really good biblical concept of love and what it means to love ourselves, we need to dig into the Word of God. If it's only the Word of God, we're going to learn what good, godly, biblical love is. We need to get into that Word. We need to meditate on it. The more we understand God's word. I think the more we're able to grasp his love for us, the more we can love ourselves with a love that is godly, with a love that is right, with a love that is honouring to him. Loving ourselves is honouring to him. He's created us. Loving ourselves is bringing honour and glory to his creation. So, choice. You know, it is a choice. It's a command and a choice to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. It's a choice to love ourselves and our neighbours. And it's a daily choice of surrendering that selfish I, surrendering all to God, and allowing God to fill us with his love. And so then we can love him, and we can love ourselves. I want to leave you with this wonderful story I read, which I think just really, hopefully sums up really what I want to say. Somebody speaks about their mother, oh, mother-in-law. My mother-in-law is almost 97 years old. She has many limitations because of health issues, but she can still get around because of an electric scooter. She lives in an assisted living facility. She is a person of deep faith who has been an inspiration to me, her family, and many others who have come to know her. It is obvious that she recognizes each new day as a gift and makes choices accordingly. She could choose to sit in front of her TV all day, except for meal times. She could choose to stay to herself and ignore the world outside her room, but she doesn't make those choices. In fact, she is one of the most active senior residents in the home. She goes to Bible study regularly, and almost all of the other scheduled activities, including the exercise classes, even though she always has pain and discomfort. She visits her friends and neighbours and offers companionship for the journey. Each day she chooses to live life as fully as possible in a conscious awareness of others and their needs. She takes advantage of the opportunities each new day offers. She chooses to embrace life. In a sense, she chooses whom she will serve as long as she has breath. Why? Because she recognizes her worth in God. Because she loves herself and grasps life in all its fullness according to the plan and purpose of God. I think that's a really lovely testimony of a lady's life, and it's a testimony I would love to be able to say or to live up to if I could. Can't do it without God. But this lady, she chooses to reach out to people. She chooses to make a difference because she knows the love of God, because she knows she's loved by him, and thus she can love herself. And in the security of this knowledge, then she's able to go out and show people that love, and love upon people. So, choose to love yourself. I just want to remind you of Joyce Meyer's quote again. There's something important here that I think people often miss. You cannot give away something that you don't have in you. How can someone love another person if they don't love themselves? I know from my own personal testimony and my own walk with God that this is a continued journey. I thought after counselling, I love myself, everything's great now. And as I keep catching Lindsay's eye, Lindsay will tell me that I still struggle. I live with Lindsay, by the way. It's a long journey, but today is the beginning of a new day. Today is the beginning of the rest of your life. And if you are really struggling with this today, or you know you really struggle, I think if all of us were honest, I think we would say we do. You know, today is a new day. All that's gone on has gone. It's past. It's finished. God has forgiven it. When he's forgiven, it's forgotten. And today you come before him and say, you know, God, I really do struggle to know your love for me and to love myself. I really struggle to recognize that I'm worthy to love myself. Lord, Father, help me to see myself through your eyes. Help me to make the right choice. It starts with choice. Standing on the word of God. Help me to take choice. Take by choice the word of God into my heart and stand on it and believe in it. And Lord, as I stand on the truth of your word, as I stand and believe that I am worthy of love, that I love myself, as I stand on that, I choose to love myself, will you make that more and more and more a reality in my heart and in my life? Nothing else will fulfill those deep needs within us. Nothing. We need God. Let's pray. The Lord just saying those words, we need you, brings us back to that song that we were singing. How we need you, Lord. We need you, Father Jesus. Lord, Father, I really acknowledge within me that my selfish desires, that the enemy within me can really rise up, and so often it can catch me unawares. So often it can rise up and I don't even realize, and it can cause so much hurt and so much pain. And Lord, I want to say I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry, Father, when I'm unable to control myself, when I'm unable to really be free, to allow you to take control fully. Lord, and I thank you that as I say sorry, and if any of my brothers and sisters are joining me in the knowledge that they struggle with that too, Lord, I thank you that as we ask for your forgiveness, that you look to Jesus Christ and you proclaim that we are forgiven. Lord, I thank you that right now, this moment is the beginning of a brand new moment, a brand new day, a brand new week, a brand new month, a brand new year ahead of us. And Lord, I want to ask for me and my brothers and sisters here today that you, Lord Father God, over this week, over this year, will give us such a deeper understanding of what it means to be loved by you and to love ourselves. Lord, will you help us to see ourselves through your eyes? Help us to see those diamonds. Help us to see that we are loved, precious, valuable. And Father, help us when temptation comes. Help us to be like Joseph. Help us, Father, to stand up and say, no, because I love myself. I love my God. I know that if I gave in, I know if I did this, I know the consequences will be huge. And I don't want to bring that hurt and pain into my life, into your life, into God's life. I don't want that. Help us to say no, Lord. Help us to love ourselves enough to recognize that when we step out of your will, we are causing consequences that bring hurt. their heart right now, Lord, and that you will give them a revelation, give them a picture of how much you love them, Lord. Will you overwhelm them right now with your presence, Lord? Overwhelm them with your love, Lord. Make your love tangible, Father, to us. Truth, Lord.